Good evening, Calicut. Good evening, Calicut. Good evening, Calicut. Thanks. My name is Arun. I've been asked by the LitFest organizers to talk in 15 minutes about a very simple subject, the history of technology in independent India. And to know more, please, when you get a chance and if you have an interest in the subject, please take a look at my book. It's called Midnight's Machines. It's available in the bookstall here. The reason why I picked this book as a subject is evada nokiyalum we are hearing about plastic surgery, instances of plastic surgery performed in ancient India and how the first planes were flown in India in the form of Pushpak Vimanam. So I was wondering whether there were no instances of technological advancement that Indians had during the time of, from the time of independence, from 1947 to now, that we could really talk about and write about. And the fact is that there were. And to start on the subject, let me end where Karyashri sir began, which is on the subject of Gandhi. And he spoke eloquently about the role of Gandhi in the freedom movement, as well as the role of Gandhi in shaping the modern ideals, the ideals of the modern republic today. But Gandhi was a man who deeply mistrusted machines. In 1933, the great science fiction writer Aldous Huxley wrote to Jawaharlal Nehru, who would later become the first Prime Minister of India, saying views of Gandhi towards technology were deeply anti-science. And why was it that this man who held sway over the entire nation had such a problematic view towards science and technology and machines in general? And Jawaharlal Nehru wrote to Aldous Huxley back saying, no, no, this is not the right view of Gandhi. You know, his intentions may be sincere. I agree that the logic is faulty. But the fact is that it is true that Mahatma Gandhi mistrusted machines. And so it fell upon the political heir of Mahatma Gandhi, who was Jawaharlal Nehru, to re-energize science and technology in India, which unfortunately he could not, because the political legacy of Gandhi was still alive and well, although Gandhi was tragically assassinated soon after independence. The political legacy of Gandhi was alive and well, and therefore the modern republic was born into a time where much of our citizens mistrusted machines. And that is the legacy of technology in India. And that's where the story of technology begins in 1947, deeply problematic and deeply skeptical of what went on by way of scientific achievements or in terms of our scientific and technological legacy in India. And it wasn't always the case. Everybody did not agree with Mahatma Gandhi in their views towards technology. Many of you may have encountered Jawaharlal Nehru's views himself in the book Discovery of India, where he talks about the scientific temper and whatnot. There were other scientists and other technocrats, Meghnad Saha, the great engineer Mokshagundam Vishwesharaya, and Madan Mohan Malaviya, who was recently conferred the Bharat Ratna, who not only contradicted Mahatma Gandhi, but also wanted the country to deeply embrace machines. Unfortunately, their views did not get much traction because, like I said, Mahatma Gandhi became the leading light of the Indian freedom movement and Jawaharlal Nehru became his political heir and the first prime minister of the independent country. And both of them deeply mistrusted machines. What is the legacy of Gandhi and Nehru vis-a-vis technology? Now, we should thank them for making India into the pluralist republic that it is today. But with regards to technology, both of them have a deeply problematic legacy. They have a deeply troubling legacy in that Gandhi did not want technology to be embraced by the ordinary Indian public. He did not want technology to be introduced in villages. Jawaharlal Nehru famously said, I think in the early 50s, that he did not want a tractor in the Indian farm. Because he thought machines, the more modern they are, the more lazy that they would make the average Indian citizen. Now, this may have been true in 1950s India, where the lifespan of the average Indian was, I think, between 35 and 45, and the average Indian was illiterate. So the fact is that it may well have been true that modern machines may have corrupted Indian citizens, but there was no reason for Nehru or Gandhi to prevent the embrace of technology by Indians in the early 40s. And Nehru himself realized this mistake, which is why in the second industrial plan, 1956, he embraced machines in a big way and created the edifice of the modern industrial state, and many of you would have heard the term, the temples of modern India, the great dams that created the engine of the Indian industrial state. And that is where the history of technology in independent India began. The fact is that we were born into the atomic age. We were born at the end of the Second World War in 1945. And the Second World War seeded most modern technologies known to man. You name it, plastics, food processing, antibiotics, radar, microwave technology. All the technologies that are used by man in the modern era were seeded by the Second World War for military and civilian uses. When India became independent in 1947, they realized that most of these technologies were not available to us because these were limited by what are called export control regimes, either by the United States or the USSR. But it stands to the credit of Indian diplomacy that we were still able to secure these technologies despite all the secrecy and despite all the export control regimes that were created and put in existence to prevent precisely such technologies falling in the hands of India. So in 1963, if I'm not mistaken, the first rocket launch happened in Tumba, in Thiruvananthapuram. The rocket came from the United States. It was a Nike Apache rocket. The computer to monitor the launch, as well as the helicopter that was used to surveil the launch, came from the USSR, the Soviet Republic. The sodium vapor, which was the payload used for the rocket, came from France. So despite all the difficulties that we had to secure technology from abroad, the Indian diplomats of that age did a fantastic job in convincing other countries to give us very sensitive material. But the fact is that while we had access to nuclear technology and even space technology, leaders like, you know, the legacy of Gandhi was carried forward by Gandhians like Joseph Kumarappa, and including leaders like Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, did not believe in providing civilian technology to Indians. They believed that technology would corrupt the modern Indian mind and they would become enslaved to machines. As a result of which, there was this great mistrust that was created in the mind of the average Indian citizen. And it took nearly 3 decades for that mistrust between the citizen and machine in India to be bridged. And the book, in many ways, is a catalog of how the mistrust was abridged. The fact is that now we are talking about solar cookers and solar technology, but in 1952, the Indian government actually tried to seed the first prototype of a solar cooker. The solar cooker failed miserably. It was an experiment by the National Physical Laboratory. It failed miserably. Jawaharlal Nehru did not want to admit failure of the solar cooker, so the news was buried in the press. News was buried by the press at that time and by the government establishment. But the fact is that the scientific failures of our time were not recorded, and we only kept on hearing successes of institutions like ISRO or the Baba Atomic Research Center, which is all great, and today we are asked to admire the spectacle of a space launch, but the fact is that we don't have any civilian technology that can industrialize the country. That is because the stories of failure in the 40s, in the 50s, in the 60s were not told to us as Indian citizens. And the book in many ways tells you the story of the failures of the Indian state to develop technologies. One of the failure stories is the story of the solar cooker. Another failure is the one to create an indigenous computer. In the early 50s and the 60s, India tried to create what was called the TIFRAC, created by the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. It was modeled on the computers that had been developed by the United States and the USSR, but unfortunately it was not scalable and you could not produce it for the market. As a result of which, IBM came into the country, started selling cheap and obsolete machines to the country, and eventually became in many ways held a monopoly on the Indian market with regards to machines. Another failure of the Indian establishment is to create its own nuclear power plants. Till 1970, the Indian nuclear power establishment could not create a single megawatt of electricity to power the electricity grid. Not 1 megawatt of electricity was supplied by India's nuclear power plants to the electricity grid for ordinary Indians. The fact is that there were many failures. And in the United States, for example, there is this adage that you have to welcome failure in order to welcome success. But the fact is that we suppressed failure for the longest time, that we could not understand what our successes were. And it took until 1999 when the Y2K crisis hit and cyberspace and computing became such a big thing in India. Till then, we could not really understand what the successes and the legacies of India were with regards to its technological advancement. In 1965, when the first batch of IIT Kanpur, and IIT Kanpur probably has one of the best computer science faculties in the country even today. In 1965, when the first batch of IIT Kanpur graduated, the United States passed, the president at that time was a guy called Lyndon B. Johnson. And Lyndon B. Johnson created this law called the Immigration and Naturalization Reform. When the first batch of IIT Kanpur graduated, they were pulled into the United States on account of this reform, which essentially meant that the first brain drain, the first instance of brain drain happened in 1965. And these were circumstances in many respects, beyond the control of India, or for that matter, beyond the control of Prime Minister Nehru. But when some of these US-trained engineers wanted to come back to India, there is this famous conversation between the US, the Indian ambassador to the United States and Jawaharlal Nehru. And Nehru writes to the US ambassador saying, look, I have been petitioned by all these engineers who have been trained in the IITs and who are studying in the United States. They all want to come back to India. But when they come back to India, they realize that the engines and the machines that are available in India are outdated. So they crib and complain about the machines available in India. So he wrote to the US ambassador saying, please, can you tell them to stay in the United States itself? This was the approach of Nehru towards, in many respects, our engineers and our technologists. And unfortunately, the story of Nehru and scientific temper and all the wonderful things that that India's first prime minister did to improve and to enhance our understanding of science, all of that notwithstanding, there has been a great deal of whitewashing that has been done of Nehru's legacy of technological advancement in India. And I say this as an admirer and supporter of Nehru because criticism has to start from within, which is why it is possible today for the Sangh Parivar to say, look, the first instance of aerodynamics in India was Pushpak Viman driven by Ravan, or the first instance of cosmetic surgery in India was the instance of a head being transplanted on a head of an elephant being transplanted on a god. The fact is that we have to reconcile ourselves to the failures of the Indian state in advancing technology. Once we embrace our failures, the hope is that we will have a better understanding of what Nehru couldn't do, which is that he was unable to create an industry that could perform for the market. The solar cooker was one such example. When the famous pharmaceutical company Merck came to India for the first time, Nehru was leading the negotiations on the Indian side. He did not trust a US company to create penicillin for Indians. And therefore, negotiations between Merck, which is still a famous US pharmaceutical company, and India broke down. As a result of which, the antibiotics market in India nearly took 4 decades to grow. So these, let me end on this note, which is that, and let me reiterate, the book is, of course, just a glimpse into the years of Indian independence, but it is also important to understand the failures of the Indian state. They begin with 1947 and they do not end in 1947 or at Nehru. It goes on till 2019, and the failures of the Indian state must be appreciated better to understand where we should go tomorrow. Thank you.